Okay. So, so today we have assortativity, and then we're going to go a little berserk with some more contagion stuff. We're going to see what happens when we put contagion on simple random networks with arbitrary degree distributions with assortativity added on. Okay? So we're just creeping away from, you know, we started with Poisson. We went to the things with arbitrary degree distributions. We're very happy with ourselves. And now we'll add assortativity, which is there are different flavors of assortativity. And we'll also then move off onto networks where we have, I mean, it just takes a while to get there, right? We won't even consider weighted networks. It's just, that's extremely hard. We could get to that. That's a whole area to add, but we won't do that today, surely. We will look at networks that have directed edges and undirected edges mixed in a controlled way. Right, so you can imagine you can go straight to directed ones, so they have directions, or we could stay with undirected ones. But there's a very nice way, beautiful way actually, of thinking about networks that have those things combined. And so you might see how you could, you know, generalize from there. So we'll see. We'll put contagion on that. It's going to be messy. Okay, so there'll be some horrible things with generating functions. We'll do things in a couple of different ways. There's a generating function approach from Newman, Mark Newman, who's famous in all of this, and then some work that's come out of a couple of a European group, which is more a sort of a probabilistic description. Okay. all right. So I want to start with this ridiculousness. I started the thing, right? Yeah. Of course. Yeah. But the other thing. Yeah. All right. Sorry. Okay. So. At the end of PUX, right, Principles of Complex Systems, I talked about universality. You know, it's a thread through the whole thing. It's a gigantic story. And I got very excited about it. And talked about, let's find it. You know, one fun example is this, right? It's hexagons, right? So we were talking about it in the context of fluid mechanics. So, right, good examples. These are into this sort of thing. Giant's Causeway, which if you're a fan of... Hellboy, one of the Hellboy movies, they end up on this thing. Yeah, that's where they end up. This is kind of an interior, apparently, but lava cooling, forming these things, so that's pretty cool. Graphene, which is this, you know, so the European Union, one of their big, they're trying to make the brain, you know, make a copy of the brain, basically, is one of their big pursuits over the next 10 years, and graphene is the other one, right? It has all this amazing behavior, so it's carbon in a new form. We kind of have to make it. Chicken wire, so if this is from the Blues Brothers. No? Anyone? Okay. I came across this. I was tweeting something about Chinese checkers, right? Chinese checkers is very interesting. It's a cool game, right? So it's on a hexagonal lattice. And it's also basically just sort of a horrible traffic jam game with no killing. You know, it's not a violent game, right? It's not like chess where you must slay the others or go where you sort of encircle them, obviously. So you kill them. What's that? Yeah, it's just a mess, actually. It's just sort of like, you know, it's a traffic jam game. And you have certain ways of hopping. So I tweeted something in it, and then ridiculously, so there are certain things if you tweet, right? If you tweet something's inconceivable, then Inigo Montoya will retweet that instantly, right? And say, I do not think you know what that word means. There's this site, which is pretty outstanding, called HexNet, which is the Global Hexagonal Awareness Resource Center initiative. And they're totally psyched about hexagons. So it's got all sorts of good stuff. You know, you should check it out. Because, you know, I'm definitely a hexagon fanboy, but I didn't realize that there was this possibility. Look at this. T-shirts. You really should. Because it is, so it's the great 2D lattice. That's the thing. It's isotropic. It looks like a normal sort of solid when you squeeze it, so it appears in lots of ways. It's the best packing structure. There's lots of good things about the hexagon, right? And there's just a little bonus here. It's on the end of Saturn. Saturn made the right choice with the North Pole. It's just this giant hexagon, which is a little confusing to people, but super cool. So I'm going to play this because this is ridiculous. Did you see this?
Yeah, I watched it.
Can I? I'm going to. Okay. I don't know if it's going to explode the sound. Oh. Okay, so we're not, it's under control, right? Yes, see? Hexagons are so choice, the most holy of shapes. See, this is actually pretty good. Pretty good. You know, YouTube is the very bad place to look at comments usually. Thanks, so it's a Freemason thing. That's a good call. It definitely has the feel of the, Da Vinci Code type thing. Anyway, so there's some goodness in that. I think that's good. Yeah, so you should explore this. Get the t-shirt. Cool. All right, so more episodes are up. All these things are up. And we're going to carry on, as I said, with a couple of pieces. I'm going to start with applications of random networks. So I've talked about this a little bit before in PoX. But yeah, so if you're in, we have some interest from the audience. and you should know about this. I'm not sure about lights. Lights. Optimal sleeping arrangement. Bring your cushions. That's when the eyelids. Okay. So we're going to talk about how we build them before I start throwing you food. Like a bunch of well-trained animals. yeah. Okay. So, yeah, I should get that book on exotic animal training, right? It was a really nice piece. It was actually written by a woman who used to live here. And she had this fantastic op-ed called, in the New York Times, called What Shamu Taught Me About Love. You should look this up, because she's watching these, you know, a giant orca or whatever, all this sort of business, you know, they're being trained. And there's one thing that, you know, they'll use is shunning the animal when it doesn't do the right thing. So just no emotion. It's not, you don't get angry, don't get excited, you just simply shun them. And so she's watching this, and then she puts in this in her margin on her notes, try on Scott, which is her husband. So she did, and it was actually quite effective. Yeah, there's a number of different things, like giving them an activity somewhere else so they don't annoy you. Anyway, the great ending is that he starts to try that. She realizes that he's reversed it, and he's working on her. Anyway, so fun stories. All right, so let's see. So, all right, so we've got this. So a very good problem is, here's a real network, like, you know, what's the structure? Okay, what's the structure? And we'll get to structure detection in the next big set of stuff that's coming after all this. And we know that degree distribution is the big deal. Right, that's it took us a long time to figure that out. We were obsessed with Poisson for a long time. But, you know, nature doesn't produce those things at all. So, right, that's our first thing. So now we want to measure some other properties around that. We've talked about assortativity. We've talked about clustering, you know, these various other little pieces that, you know, and we don't have really a great taxonomy in some ways. We just have degree distribution, and then there's all these other things that seem to matter. And we'll show how it matters, for example, for contagion with respect to assortativity today. All right, so, well, so we could take a random network with the same frequency distribution, degree distribution, and mess it up, make random versions of it. So we have to think about how to do that, make random versions, and then look at how this ensemble of randomized versions depart in some way from the real one, right? You have one example of the real one, whatever it is, a gene-gene interaction network, whatever the thing is, it's some real thing. And then you want to mess around with it, randomize it in some way. So it's interesting, right? Networks are very nasty things to deal with statistically. It's easy to get things that are correlated with each other in strange ways that you're not thinking about. It's hard to cloak them, for example. It's hard to anonymize people, and when there's network data around, you can usually uncover, it's very disturbing actually, you usually uncover a node with just a little bit of information. You know, the real person's name. Okay, so, all right. So we want to create what I'll call an ensemble, right? We want to create a whole bag of networks that are the same in terms of degree distribution, and that's it. Otherwise, they're random. Otherwise, they're completely random. All right, so how do we do this? So here's one of the first ideas, and it remains sort of the base of how you would do this, and we have code for doing it. You know, there are black box type things sitting around. This is what they should be doing underneath the hood, so you need to appreciate that. So even if you use the black boxes, you need to know that they're doing these things. So we'll start with, so we have some real network, and basically we break it up into these little things with stubs, right? So some node that had three friends, we just pull it out and we put ends on it and make these little stubs, right? You can think of it kind of like this. Newman did some of the first stuff here, and so that's probably a term he first used. So you end up with a whole batch of these guys, and now you have to start wiring them up again. So you've destroyed the, you know, the Lego thing, and now you're going to put it back together in a big mess and see if it looks like the original one. Right, and you're going to put it back randomly, so probably not. But it's a network, so you can't even understand what it looks like because it's a big mess anyway. But basically, that's what we're doing. Take the Lego set, smash it to pieces, randomly rewire it, and then say, wow, I don't, yeah. But you make an ensemble of random ones and see how they, on average, split apart. Okay, so, all right, so you select from the stubs, you might make a mistake and say, well, I'm going to choose by node, right? It's always about edges. Everything is always about edges. You could say, you know, I'm going to pick this guy and this guy and then connect them. But you don't do that, right? You're connecting by stubs, right? So you're going to pick, you randomly pick from all of these little ends. Maybe you get this one and you get this one and you just glue them together. And you keep doing that. You know, and you do this in a smart way so you don't keep choosing from the same set. Your set gets smaller and smaller. And so initially, obviously, you have to have an even number, small thing. So you could just, you know, you could fudge. Well, if you've got a real network, you're fine. If you've got a, because you'll end up with an even number when you break them in half. So another thing you can do here, of course, is say, I want this degree distribution. You sample from it, and you make a whole batch of them, and then you know, you're creating them for fun, and leisure, right? You just want some for the wall, whatever you want. All right. It's been demanded from you. Okay, but you can, so you could get some self ones, some self connections, and you sort of maybe that's okay. Maybe you just, you don't care about those. But typically we're a little upset about that. And you could get repeated ones as well. No, it's probable that you don't want that to happen. Okay, so we'll clean those guys up. So a self loop would look like this, and a little double connection would look like this. So we want to rewire those in some way. So this is going to be the game, is how do you rewire this thing properly? I know I've talked about this in PUX, but we'll go through it again in a more detailed way. All right, so the first thing you might think is, this is interesting. I remember I actually thought of how to do this at Santa Fe years ago, and I remember talking to Duncan, and I said, well, it's unclear what else this is going to do, right? The thing I'll show you, it's unclear. It might be creating other biases unbeknownst to you, all right? So we sort of dropped it, but it's just hard to tell. But here's something you want to be very, here's the first thing you say, okay, here's my network, I'm just going to pick up an edge, right, and then just go and put it back down somewhere else. And then do that again, just randomly rewire both ends. So the problem with that is you end up with a process, you're now destroying the degree distribution, right? You're taking one away from this guy here, the likelihood that you put it back, well, you know, it's small, it's 1 over n times 1 over n. So it's just going to make a big soup. And you'll get back to these Poisson ones. All right, so that's no good. So we want to preserve our degree distribution. We really don't care about anything else. okay, so we can't just move links around. So so we can't just do one. So if we start to move one, obviously we have to move edges. So if we move one edge, we have to balance what we've done there. So one way, so clearly we're going to have to involve another edge in some way. So the first thing you think about, the next step is to think about how to do it with just two edges. Right? We don't want to have something where we have to sort of somehow move 17 edges around. Given we can't rewire one edge by itself without messing things up or having to remember kind of what we've done, the next step is to go to just moving two edges. All right. So here's our plan. So we're going to say these are on our list to rewire, right? We want to rewire this one. We'll be able to do it with this general rewiring approach. I mean, you could just say, let's just break it up and just throw it somewhere else. That's fine. Just pick this guy up and throw it somewhere else. But this one, we'll want to do this in a kind of a clean way. So you mark the ones that are problematic. All right, so randomly choose two edges. So we have a degree four here, degree three here, degree four here, degree three. So we want to preserve that. Those, you know, these nodes are labeled as I have here, I1, I2. They're labeled. They're specific nodes. You think about your real network that you had it originally. You know, this one had 17 connections, a random number. Then you have to, it still has to have 17 at the end of the day. All right. Or you can choose your problem edge. But we're going to randomly choose these two guys. And they have to be disjoint, fair enough, so otherwise we could mess things up. So, fine. Now you need a list of all your edges, and we're going to randomly choose from that list. So you just do that in a good way. It's easy to do. So, make sure they're disjoint. You don't have to check if you do it the right way. So we're going to rewire one of them. All right. So let's rewire this top one. We randomly choose one end of it, and then we rewire it to one of the nodes here. Right, so we're going to randomly choose an end of each edge. So we in this case, we randomly chose this end, and we slide it up to here. So the degree of these nodes has not changed. This one lost a connection, but it gained one. This one never lost one. This one lost one, but gained one, and this one never lost one. So you can think of this as, you know, in the network, you have, in principle, the connection between every two pairs of nodes. And there's ones and zeros, right? So there are, if you like, there's a zero here and a zero here, and a one here and one here if you look on the adjacency matrix. So if you find every four cycle with one zero, one zero, then you just rotate that little cycle. So it's a little broken cycle. So you just rotate this around, and that's what you can think of it like that. So you could also do this, you know, and you could see this might start to make more of a mess. You could choose a little kind of a six cycle, right? So three edges and you rotate through all of them, where there's an on off, on off, on off, and you go like that, and that would do the same thing. That's interesting as to how much more of a mess that would make. Never really thought about that. Right, so there's a bit of a concern though, right? So we know we haven't messed with the degree. We know we're kind of, there's a randomness we're introducing because these two are unrelated to each other. So we know we're kind of, it looks like we're going to randomize it. But the, there is sort of a lingering concern that we're not doing anything bad. All right. Okay, so we can just lie awake at night thinking about that. But this it's a pretty good plan. It works pretty well. Okay. So you can use it on those problem ones that we started with, right? If there's a repeat one or a loop one, you can use this process. Because we want to randomize this thing properly, right? So there's a, well, I'll show you, there's a reason for doing it a little bit beyond this. So you could just randomly connect these up, and you're going to have the right degree distribution. But it turns out we need to go a little step further. And I'll show you why. I'll show you sort of an extreme example that's been used. Because there are a couple of methods proposed this is sort of the early 2000s. And they both seem good, but it turns out they have biases. And there's a third one which is much harder, and I'll just point to it. It's much harder to do practically, but you can see theoretically it works spectacularly. Anyway, but you don't do it. So we, you know, usual thing. Computer scientists are happy with that. So we do this, and then here's sort of a, you know, ad hoc kind of thing. So we get the thing connected, we clean it up so it doesn't have any self loops or any double or triple repeat loops. And then we just go berserk and randomize this thing a lot, right? So we get in there and we use this thing over and over again. And the rough idea, and there's a paper you can go to, for every edge you want it to have had a chance to randomize maybe 10 times, right? So that's good. I mean, obviously more is good, but that's a fair amount of messing around. And it can also mean, right, so if this edge, right, so if this edge gets randomized, it's still attached to this original one, but you give it 10 shots, it's going to detach from its original, it's going to be actually moved somewhere else in the network altogether. Quite random. It depends, obviously, also on the entropic nature of the network. If it's a really, hard thing to start mixing with, right? So a plus on is nice and messy. So you'll be able to, every pair of edges you choose will probably be able to, you'll probably be able to do this. Others, it becomes harder. All right. Okay, so why can't you just do the stub thing? Because that would, and then, just clean up a little bit. It's pretty good. Here's the sort of just the nutshell for this. So that's a paper. I think it just lives in the archive, to be honest. I don't think it was actually published, but it's a nice bit of work because it's the two groups kind of came together and solved that problem. So here we have, you choose an extreme pathological example. And show that it's problematic. So it's a configuration where you have, in principle, n minus two of the nodes have one in and one out degree. And then there's one node that has n minus two out and n minus two in for this guy. So that's a bit of a funny set. So there's one way you can do this because these are all, again, labeled, but the edges aren't labeled, so this is just... Right, there's just this one representation here, one structure that looks like this that's going to pop out, because we can just sort of shuffle these guys. They aren't really ordered from top to bottom. And then there are, there's some n that was chosen. So what is it? 10 choose 9. All right, 10 choose 2 times a couple. Okay, so I think that's right. Yeah, all right, 10 times 9. Okay, so we have this, right? So you could go to one of these characters, and then they have to have an outlink, that has to have an inlink, and then we get to that, right? And then so you can see that if you're just choosing from stubs early on, there's a really good chance you're going to connect these two. All right. And that's okay. I mean, there are 90 distinct configurations like that. There's one of this, so it should be a 1 to 90 ratio. So it's hard to read this. This is the stubs one. So the problem is it gets this guy far too few times, basically. Right? But if you start with this and then start randomizing it, brings up its frequency of occurrence, and it's okay, right? So you want this is like 1/91, right? So you want this to appear once, all of these guys to appear the same amount of, with the same frequency, right? 1/91 for each of these. It's too uncommon for this. And it's because of that you're choosing from stubs early on. There's so many ways to get one of these and one of these early on and glue them together. So this is just a hard thing to find with the stub matching.
So it's a failure in the sense that it's not sampling at the right rate as opposed to not getting all the
It makes them. It makes them, but it's not doing the thing you want, which is to create an ensemble of all possible networks with that degree distribution, such that they're all equiprobable. Yeah, right. So you'll find it. Yeah, but and is it? I mean, it's much less of a probably here. So this is, of course, one that's made up. There's another, we don't have to worry about this, go with the winners, which is a more, elaborate kind of thing, which you really know it's going to do the right thing. The shuffling one sort of feels okay, but there's always this, maybe it's doing something sneaky to it. But it does the right thing. Okay. All right, so, it's a sneaky bit of code to write, but it's, you can make a mess of things. But once you have it, it's all good. All right. Okay, so I've mentioned this. We could just have an underlying degree distribution that we're entranced with. You know, we want a power law or whatever it is. And so then you have to, you select from that distribution, you know, you have a whatever, you say you want 10,000 nodes, you select from the degree distribution in a good way. It's just, right, sampling from a distribution. So you create your whole set of nodes, and then you start hooking them up. It's no problem. You can do this. Of course, the distribution's on a discrete set, so it's fine. And then you can always, if there's not an even number, of course, you just add one to one somewhere. That's not a big deal. So you can certainly also have degree distributions that don't give you, and your number might be too small, that, you know, they don't work out, right? So you have to play with that a little bit. Anyway, that's fine. That's pretty cool. Okay, so then the second part of this is, and this was the application, so it's Yuri Alon's work. Maybe it's 2001 or 2, appeared in Nature Genetics, I believe. Alon is the head of the group. So wasn't in Nature, I don't think. But they had a whole stream of papers that were published everywhere. Okay, so let's see. So transcriptional regulation networks, E. coli, of course. So they have, this data, of course, changes over time, but there are about 600 interactions between, so not, you know, again, you know, these sparse kinds of networks, it's not huge. But they're trying to find what sort of small-scale structures which could be connected to mechanisms are present in these networks, in these real networks. and so they've gone on and done this for all sorts of things, like food webs and actually electrical circuits that we've created. You know, we've certainly built things in that we know what we're doing. But there are certain things we use over and over, and you can go in and try and figure out what our biases are. Okay, so all right, so now we're looking at this small scale thing. And the idea is you have your real network, smash it to pieces, make a whole, 10,000 copies of it, and then look to see if there are some statistical differences about some things that you think are interesting. So it's a really hard problem to say, well, here are all the possible things that could be interesting, right? That, or to sort of strategically go through them all. We typically do things like look for clustering, look for assortativity, and so on. All right, so here's a, I just sort of threw this up in PUC, so we can look at it in a little more detail here. It's a very nice example. So so-called feed-forward loop, right? So X turns on, it starts promoting Y, and then Y turns on, but X is also involved in getting Z going. So, but there's a delay here, right? So there's a delay because it's saying, yes, you can start, but it's like, no, I don't know about Y. And so Y turns on, Z turns on. So that's that basic structure. This is the actual example. So there's an AND. There's an AND in here. And so here's the input of X. Here's an example. It starts to turn on Y, but nothing comes out at Z. So it has a resilience, right? This is a nice little simple structure that says, unless X is really going, don't turn on, right? Y jumps up straight away, so it gets a little excited. This creates a buffer. X runs for a longer time, then Y really starts to ramp up, and then that gives Z a good chance to do the same thing. Eventually it turns off, but then there's this relaxation time in Z as well. So it has this other part as well. It's hard to turn on, and then it has a slow decay at the other end. So the analogy is an elevator door, right? So you want it to react very quickly on one thing, but when your hand is out of the way, you want it to react slowly and dopily and not scrunch you. Okay, so So that's elevator doors. So that's one that they found, and that was a nice piece of work. There are a bunch of others. They showed that these things appeared disproportionately in the real network versus the randomized one, right? So when you randomize it, you get rid of the feed-forward loops. They tend to disappear. And in fact, it was the only motif with three nodes that appeared in a disproportionate. Okay. You can have that. didn't get very far today. Okay, so this is a master switch, right? This guy's like, boom, everyone gets turned on. And evolution produces these structures. It's good to have these. It's actually good to have these sorts of things, right? There's an element of, you want the whole, this is not what this does, but you want the whole organism to grow more or less. Then it would be very bad to have a very complex kind of thing that said, well, this guy has to grow a bit over here and this bit has to grow. You want something that can dial the whole thing up and down in a consistent kind of way. So that's that sort of stuff has to appear in these, this software, right? We are algorithms. Okay, so and then they had this one as well, which is this sort of, there's a whole mess of switches turning on a whole mess of outputs. So this was just sort of a massive thing. So, this original paper had it was a nice piece of work. There was definitely some curation of what things you might look for. Combinatorially, it's a disaster, right? So 5, 6, 7 nodes, there's just a bazillion ways to combine them, and it's directed and all sorts of things. So they did 3 and they did 4. And then they went to these kind of bigger stories. There's work by, that's the story. So there's work by Chris Wiggins, who was at Columbia, still at Columbia, who's now the, it's really cool, he's a great guy. So he's now the chief data scientist at the New York Times, which is really cool. So, yeah. A physicist who worked on things like the flapping of flags and the tails of little small things that swim in the water. originally, I saw him years ago give a talk at MIT, I guess, when he was looking for jobs. This is the late 90s. And so we were at Columbia together for a while. So, so he's doing cool things now as well. But he really worried about this problem. So how do you strategically go through and say, all right, I want to look at all the threes, sub-networks of size 3, 4, 5, 6. And so there's, if you're interested in this, you can dig into that some more. I know some groups play around with this. I think Mary Dunlop's done some of this. I mean, maybe? Okay. All right. Yeah, I could add a Wiggins link. But the principle is very good, and nice to be able to build. So this is a nice way to build networks. We had the Poisson. We have a way. We just throw the edges down. Here's a way to build them strategically. And of course, you could start to see what you might do if you have modules and so on, and other kinds of restrictions. All right. Well, that's good. That's been hanging around. Been meaning to talk about that one. What is wrong with the sound on this thing? Let me just check. I know it's going to do bad things for me. Yeah, it is, actually. Yeah. Naughty. Output. Can I make a noise? Yes! This is important. We need the music. Great. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. That's right. Ought. Yeah. Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it's based on, medieval. Yeah. But it's not, this is 1915 or something, 930 or something like that. Anyway, it's totally great. Yes. Okay. Just the best. Okay, so you can enjoy that. Just put your hood down and right. You definitely have to. Hood's not the right word. What's the word? Your cloak. There's something. What? Your cowl. You have a cowl. If you're an evil monk, you have a cowl, right? Okay. Yeah. Or a good monk. I don't know. But it feels more like. Okay. Monks are good guys. Okay. So that was a success. So there you go. Total. I hope that music makes sense with that particular. It's well chosen. Okay. Awesome. And that's good because I just have some random little Easter eggs in this one. It's a thing that got spread around a lot, but we talk about spreading, so that's okay. So assortativity. All right. So we. That wasn't in that one. Really simple thing. That was looking at motifs. But another thing you can do with that random rewiring thing is you take your real note guy and you randomly rewire, and then you look at the clustering of these guys in this ensemble versus the real one. You look at z-scores and so on and see how far away it is. or assortativity. So we've mentioned it, homophily, right? How much, so it's the birds of a feather story. So nodes that are alike in some way, how much do they, what affinity do they have for each other in these networks? And so we'll go through a number of different kinds of possible conceptions of assortativity. And so there's also disassortative, right? So we'll look at that as well. So the nodes that are dissimilar may be connected. So, you know, we're very sort of natural to think of ones where people in social networks are connected for, you know, the birds of a feather sort of thing. But then you have this sort of strange opposites attract, right? We have this kind of, we have a saying for every version of the story we want. So anyway, so yeah, Facebook, you could look at all this data. All right. Okay, so usual story. Random networks are cool. Let's keep moving away from them. A little bit, just a little bit, before we muddle the whole shebang. So correlations between nodes is a very simple thing. I mean, correlations are just a fundamental piece of all sorts of, you know, materials, whatever it is, physical systems. What are the correlations? You know, we've studied things like, what are the correlations of happiness in social networks? It's just a very natural, ridiculous kind of question. But just in general, it's just, you know, correlations in landscapes, there's all sorts of things where you look for correlations. So we'll build them in and play with them, see what happens, right? So see what happens when you spread on correlated networks. So for example, you know, a good question is, if the networks are more correlated based on some, you know, attribute, does that make the thing spread more or spread less? You know, more susceptible to spreading or less. And you know, every now and then there's a paper that basically says the same thing, which is like, oh, you know, if you just spread it to, you know, within your local group, it doesn't get very far. You know, okay, right, so it's a big surprise. All right, but let's see what we, you know, again, simple models, well-defined, you know, we can actually do some math, which will be painful for you and me. What's that? You said, please let there be generating functions? Yes. You are. Wow. You're in the right place. Be a good name for a pet, don't you think? Generating functions. Okay, yeah, right. That's where we're going with this. All right, so, okay. So we talk about these things, mixing. So we're going to I'll show you some a setup that, again, it comes from Newman, and then a different approach to it. There's some work by Gleason, which is very nice. And then this Bahuna and Serrano, obviously that's not how you say their names very well. And that's, yeah, I don't know, very clean, very nice. Okay. All right, so lots of randomness still, but we've added another feature to it. Okay, that's what we're going to do. All right, these guys. All right, is that really Serrano like that? Wiggins, link to Wiggins. Okay, cool. all right, so let's see. So let's just say they have categories, right? These are just attributes, very general. This could be extremely general. They're going to be directed edges. And so let's see if we can, you know, do a little math with this. It's going to be a little painful, but let's see what we'll go for, you know, in some ways the easiest, most natural, nicely connected thing, which is assortativity based on degree. Right, so high degree ones connect to high degree ones, that sort of thing, right? Or low degree to high degree, something like that. So that's something we can play with. It's fun method. Wow, that's sad. Wow, statements about the professor. Yeah. This is what they make comments about. This is what they make comments about. Can you see that?
Oh, nice. Yeah, no, you have that in your office.
Yeah, right. That's what I get. Yeah. Makes them very refillable. All right. Back to this stuff. All right, I'm going to use an implement. Okay, so so this will be our little setup. I'm going to follow it. So if you go to this paper by Newman, you can see how it all, you know, this will be the same language. I'll connect it back to some of the language we've used, but we're going to move around a little bit with notation, somewhat evil. So we're going to jump on an edge, And then it's gonna be, we think about it being directed, and we'll say, okay, what's probably that, this edge has a node of type mu, right? Which means it could have spots, whatever it is, and a node of type nu at this end, right? And there's a direction to it. This one, you know, and that feature might be that it likes marmosets. Okay. So A, and then, so we have these two pieces. A mu is then the probably that the edge has come, so we don't care about where it's going, but it came from one of type mu, right? So we have these two pieces. And B will be the probability that it is going to one of type mu, regardless of where it came from. So these things should all be connected together. But in general, we'll imagine they're categories, right? So we can actually kind of, we'll have mu is some things. They're not numbers necessarily, they're just categories, right? Likes fish, is a fish. Okay, so they're categories. So, but they're discrete, so we can build a matrix with this guy, possibly infinite because we're insane. And this guy and this guy, right? So they'll be vectors, right? So we have these vector characteristics. All right, so we have to have these things because we like probability. So that has to sum to one, right? We land on an edge and we sum up all the possible starts and ends. We have to get one for all the probabilities. Nothing evil. Sometimes we have our probabilities don't sum to one when we had the, you know, finding the largest size of a component. Slightly evil. But that's not what we're doing here. We should have these sum. So this is some matrix. If we sum across, so we sum the columns across the columns, right? We're summing. Yeah. So we end up with a nice big column vector. We're summing all the column vectors. Then we should get a mu. Right. This probably came from somewhere. So you mu is here. That's where we come from. Nu is the column index. Mu is the row index. And so the opposite story here. We sum down through the columns. We get b mu. Okay, super exciting. All right, so you know, in principle, we just need this guy, and we could, right? But notation. Okay. So let's see where we can go with these things. So at one limit, we have things that are perfectly assortative, where mu's only connect to mu's, right? The marmosets only connect to the marmosets, or the people who like marmosets only connect to people who like marmosets. Whatever it is, right? They have some characteristics. The one who wears the green hats and, okay. All right. And so this is going to have to happen. E mu nu has to equal zero if they're not equal to each other. That's it. Probably is, right? So whenever you jump on an edge, the probability that they're different is zero, probably the same is such that when you add up all, right? So you add this up. This will be this is actually just taking the trace of this guy, right, is one. Right? So you imagine that matrix, it just has numbers down here. They sum up to one, zeros everywhere else. Okay. So that's perfectly assortative. Uncorrelated. So what's it going to be? Mathematically. So it's uncorrelated. So disassortative, that has to be true because you don't want to have anyone connected to the same. Mathematically, there's a way of putting this. So no assortative. So it's just that there's no, the one on this end has no, it doesn't matter. You look at this, you get a mu, this the mu, that has nothing to do with this one. Yeah, it's right. So, okay, so this is the story. You have to have this. These are independent thing, right? So you specify, so this is why it's useful to have this notation. So we specify this A mu first and then B nu as well. And then to get E mu nu, we just multiply those guys together, right? Or we should be able to decompose them. All right. Yeah. Right. So it doesn't matter what mu is for nu, and it doesn't matter, right? So the conditional probabilities, it doesn't matter where you come from, doesn't matter where you're going to. All right. Disassortive, it's interesting. So disassortive, so again, networks, funny things, right? So here's we can easily think of a situation where we can connect nodes of a similar type. So that means, for example, you know, the ones that wear green hats, there'll be a clique of them, and they'll have green hats, and it's actually going to be a broken up network, right? So there'll be a cluster of them. If there are 73 of them, they're all connected together in some way. The ones that wear blue hats are going to be over here, and that's it. So it's going to be this clumpy network. That's what assortative networks look like. Yeah. Well, the communities are very clear then. Community detection we'll get to, but the communities are extremely clear then. The interior structure might be, you know, complicated.
Oh.
The way the green hats are connected to each other.
I guess I just always
speaking of community, we should use the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 system, the meow meow beans rating system. Anyone? No. Meow meow beans, you should watch this. Okay. Wow, that is the thread for this. It's a rating system where your friends rate you, and the fives are the fives are alive, the fours. There's some rhyme with it. You know, it increasingly goes down, and the ones don't get a rhyme because they're human garbage, right? That's sort of the end of it. Anyway, it's community. It's a good show. Super meta. all right. Anyway, so yeah, well, the communities. They'll be very clear in this because there's no connection between them. Yeah.
Okay.
So it'll be a cinch for this
case.
But as you dial the assortativity, and for this kind of thing, if you dial the assortativity away from super assortive, dial it away, you start to get connections, right? And then your modularity detection machine has to work a bit harder. Depending on how big the network is. So disassortative are tricky things to build. Right? So you have to think about that. And there's sort of a limit to what you can do. They become constraints on the mu nu. So you might, okay, we'll put together a measure for assortativity. You know, sort of typical thing. It has to be between -1 and 1, just like correlations, right? Okay. anyway, so yeah, so right, it's the internal connections within. I mean, it is in a way a measure of the community structure. It's a reflection. I mean, it's all connected. It's a community structure. The strength of the community structure is a reflection of assortativity. Okay, so let's think about this guy. Okay, so we'll. This is an assortativity coefficient, comes from Newman. Right, so here's the construction. This is a normalization on the bottom, but the idea is let's see how different the real network is from the one that you would have if you made a uncorrelated version of it, right? So this thing here is the E mu nu for the uncorrelated version. And we want to look at, how far, this is the trace, right? So that's the trace of E. You want to look at the sum along the trace is the fraction that are internal, that are like-to-like connections. Right, so it's 0.7, 0.3 of them are, across classes, 0.7 are within, for example. And then you compute, well, if the whole thing had just been randomly wired up, given the balances of things, what would you have gotten along that diagonal? That's what this is saying. You have to think about this a little bit, but this is actually the one norm of E squared, which is a little bit of joyous linear algebra. Can we try to do that? So E mu nu equals, did I get this right? A mu B nu. So E squared. Right, so we have to have E, let me do it like this, Eij, Ejk, right? That's the ijth entry of this guy. Sum of a j equals, let's say, 1 to n. Am I lying? Maybe. And then we want the one norm of this thing. We're going to sum from I equals 1 to n, and k equals 1 to n. So this piece here is E squared ij, the ijth entry. Ikth entry of that. Just definition of a matrix multiplication. And then we're just going to sum everything up in this blob. So it is, oh yeah, right. Yep. So we can rewrite this guy. So I can put this in here. I'm going to put this sum from j equals 1 to n out here. Right, pull that out. And we'll do these sums in different orders. I equals 1 to n, eij. That's the only place that the I appears. And the sum from j equals 1 to n of ejk. Yep. Right, so we're summing these guys like this. So this should be a, maybe I've got that wrong. It should be aj and bj. Right, and it's the sum from j equals 1 to n of these guys. Nope, I got it wrong. It's bj and aj, right? Is that right? Yep. That's okay. That's okay. Yep. Good. General lies. It's now lie free. Okay. So that's, you know, just some sneakiness. And it's nice to always, you know, condense things if you want. It looks fancy. Looks very fancy. Looks like you know what you're doing when you're done. Okay, but this is the story, as I've said. So the trace of E is the fraction that are within groups. And this is this funny little guy is the fraction that would be in groups, within groups, if it was, you know, the same basic underlying tendencies, but then randomly mixed up. And so this is just a normalization on the bottom so that we get a maximum of 1. So, okay, we could have it whatever we want. But we'll do this so that we can compare across networks of different sizes and different numbers of edges and feel good about ourselves. So this is just a normalization on the bottom, very similar to a correlation coefficient. We'll have that. Interesting. It's actually not lying as much. Okay, so that would be the maximum of 1, so which makes sense, right? So this trace is 1 when all the connections are within groups. This guy, full assortativity, good. And also we have this other nice piece, right? So when it is uncorrelated, then we can break this character apart and we get the nice result that this is 0. So we've constructed a nice little measure here, right? So this just becomes the same thing. These two, it's this guy minus this guy, gives you a 0 on top, okay? So we get 1 for truly assortative, 0 for uncorrelated, and then it's a bit funny at the other end. This is hard to get to. We can't dial it down to r equals minus 1. That's the limit. You can think about how it's the limit. So now you just have to have connections between right. You connect to nodes that are different. We don't have, again, it's categorical. Right, we don't have this type A type. We don't have, you know, 1, 2, 3 or anything like that. They're not numbered. That's categorical. and the minimum. So all of these other things are fixed. These are just. This is a number based on the network. This is a number. Right. These things just come out. If we dial this, if we start to change things, these. If we change the assortativity, we're not going to change these two pieces. And so the smallest we could do is get it down to 0, right? There are no within group connections. They're terrible groups. And so this would be the smallest we could get. Okay, fine. So it's just a bit of a funny measure, but good to know. This is something you can compute based on your network straight away. This is the best you could do if you start messing around with it, you know, make it more disassortative, so on. Okay, fun. Little breather. I think this character works at DreamWorks, yeah. I think it's DreamWorks. One of those, yeah. And you know, I think it's just with a, you know, an Adobe thing. Good work, Dad, right? I mean, it's pretty great. Pretty good. Yeah, there are about 12 of these. They're all about 10 seconds long. I mean, they've got millions and millions of things. Anyway, okay. Now we're okay. Okay, we're okay. More chocolate. Okay. We have some. Chocolate was eaten. You just want to believe that? I hope so. Right. Okay. All right. So let's move. So that was all categorical. Yeah. Interesting. And I think I had a note there. I think you can make a if you just have two types, you can make it spectacularly. You can get the minus one. All right. Good. So let's have a scalar quantity. Okay, so this could be a bunch of things. We could so height, of course, is continuous in some sense, but we could just put it to inches, ages, that sort of thing. Number of friends. So now this becomes probably that we'll change this again, but this is probably that a randomly chosen edge connects nodes with these values on them, right? They have numbers on them. And eventually, we'll do something where you could imagine, is that true? You can imagine they have a whole portfolio of stuff, like there's just a big vector of things about them. So you could, complicate this as much as you want. So we have the same story for AJ and BK. And now we're going to measure correlations because we have numbers. We'll just be able to reach into the box and pull out normal correlation coefficient things.
Is the difference between this E sub JK different? Is it different from the other one in that we're within the same category now? We're assigning numbers, or instead of categories, we have numbers?
Yeah, so the thing is now we have numbers, so we can actually measure averages, for example, and so on. The other one we couldn't average over green hats and red hats and snorkels.
Okay.
right? Different, yeah. So, I mean, we can average some, like the sizes of the groups and so on, but now we can actually average the quantities associated with them, yeah. So it changes the game a little bit. We get a little excited. We say, all right, so here's our correlation. We're just going to say, before we talked about probability, now we're going to weight it, right? So we can put in here JK, EJK. It's not just the amount. We're actually going to correlate the numbers. So the variation here is, here again is our uncorrelated version of it. Here's the actual one. And we're looking at, the average of this, the average of the product, right? How much that varies from what the uncorrelated one would be. Same as the adjacency divided by, the adjacency matrix contains this, the EJK, these numbers, the adjacency matrix contains it. So now J and K and so on, they're not the index, this is tricky, they're not the indices into the matrix, not 1, 2, 3, 4, right? It could be ages, right? So you've got a group of teenagers, so it's 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. They're the labels along the thing. And then there's also, 1 through 7.
But if you number them from 1 to 7, then it
is the same. But you're including the actual values of the quantities. Yeah. Yeah. Right. So these are meaningful things. They're not just the indices into the adjacency matrix. And this could be, I'm saying they're scale, right? This the scalar integers. You could say there are three decimal places or something like that. I mean, as long as they're not continuous, and you can make a matrix version of it. You can make a probabilistic one later on, which actually just eschews the gets rid of the whole matrix story. All right. I know it's a little funny. Yeah, we're gonna move one more step to degrees, and then we'll go bananas with that. Actually, yeah, because it is right. Okay, so. Okay, so this is a standard thing, deviation from, right, it's the product JK that we're worried about. We have a normalization on the bottom, so we get 1 and minus 1, right, it's been around for a while, since the early statisticians got excited about measuring things. Okay, really into eugenics, I gotta say, a lot of those early statisticians, Galton and so on, it's not a good story, to be honest. Yeah, what's that? U.S. history? Oh, yeah, no, in the English, very excited about it, yeah. It's not good. I mean, just to say, you don't want those posters up on the wall. Anyway, but the math is okay. good and evil. All right, so let's see. So, okay, then we'll get to something that's a little more, it's a real thing, and it has the benefit of being fun to play with, but it's also a real issue, right? So, degrees. Okay, so how correlated are nodes according to the degrees? all right, so it's going to be slightly different again. Right, before JK was inches, whatever it was. Now it's going to be much more connected to the network itself. It's all a bit of a mess. So and we'll use this notation. This may give you an idea of where we're going. So this is probably that we jump on an edge and it. We look at this end, and it's connected from a j plus 1 to a k plus 1. There's some direction to it, right? And I think when we get to the probabilistic description, it's much better. But this is okay. This is okay. There's sort of some you get into some troubles with making this kind of matrix version. All right. Okay. So this is good for calculations because we're thinking about if you hit a node of degree k plus 1, then it has k other friends. So in terms of thinking about contagion, this is a useful way to frame things. Okay. So you can define this, right? So this actually in principle should suggest if you give EJKs, we can think of really simple ones like E11 and E31 and E13 and E33. So we could have just a network, and everything else is zero. And just a network where we have degree 3 nodes and degree 1 nodes, and they have some balances, and they add up such that they're connected to each other. And you get everything out of these pieces, except if your network has some characters with no friends. They're not included in that because they don't connect to an edge. So if you have some characters with no mates, then you have to put that in as a separate piece, so it doesn't quite get everything, right? So you have to stipulate that this is zero or whatever it is, separately. And then the sum of over GK of this blob is 1 minus P0. That's not quite right. But you have, have to think about that. No, that's fine. No. You just throw those guys away. Okay, fine. Yeah, you just throw them away. So it's still 1. You just throw those guys away. That's right. Okay, good. So we'll look at directed networks later. But here's a simple way to get at this. Obviously, we don't want to go out of. We're going to go out of control, but we don't want to get too carried away. So let's make it undirected. EJK is equal to EKJ. Good. Okay. Just to connect back to some of the things we've said, I know we're using slightly different notation. So here's what the correlation coefficient looks like. So that AJ and BK are really our RJ and RK, which again was that probability. So P PK is probably that a node has degree K. RK was probably that it has, that you hit it from an edge, it has K other friends. You've been playing with that in that problem set. Maybe. Okay, fine. All right. So here's some real world networks. So we have to, you know, do these estimates. And this is a sneaky little bit of evil statistics. So you have some network. You want to get an you do this in different ways, but you want to get an error for an error estimate for the correlation coefficient you get. Usually we do this in some way. So here's the jackknife method is not bad. So the idea is you. I guess I'm going to explain on the next thing. Here it is. So you take an edge out and then compute the correlation coefficient for what's there, right? What's left. And then you do that. You do that, you go through and you take every edge out one at a time. So now you've got however many edges there are, that's how many, you've got all these samples. You compute the mean squared, the sum of the mean squares, sorry. That's not right. The sum of the squares of the differences, right, from what you get when you take one out to the overall one, and that gives you this estimate of an error, a square of it. You know, they should be independent. They're not quite because it's a network. So, but it's not bad. All right. So, all right. This is from, what is this? The link to this paper should be there. Link to. It's linked to in other places, but okay. Here's sort of this. I don't know how well this is going to hold up. We could look at this again. These are ideas of social networks, sort of back in the day, right? So, part of them are collaborations through in academia, which is so. There's an element of we can get at this data. Film actor collaborations, a ridiculous data set, but you know it was early on a good thing to play around with. It's the IMDb database. IMDb. So it's if you're connected to someone else, if you're in the same movie. So we talked about that in Pox, very kind of a fun thing, right? You have your Ed-ish Bacon number. Yeah. And we have one of our Story Lab members actually has a finite one. Mine is heavily infinity. But we have one that has a finite. So that's very unusual. Natalie Portman, very famous example. One with about 7, I think. Her name was Hirschlag, which is important to say. Let's see. So email address books, student relationships. So yeah, that's getting at some real sort of social or some version of it. So you see the assortativity for these guys is generally positive. It's not true here. And you know, this is a small network. Should be redone. So these are sort of grouped as being social. You know, again, we could work on this. Technological here, we have power grid, the internet. Well, web. So you know, different things. I mean, the web is kind of an interesting beast. these guys are on the negative side. This one's definitely, you know, at least according to this measurement, being 0 and 0. Software dependencies. So this is probably Linux, something like that. It's a good data set. We looked at that one for Debian, right? That was something we talked about in PUX. Was how that one grew. And then these biological ones, right? So food webs, difficult things to measure, as we've talked about at times. Different kinds of food, you're right, you have to go and count who's eaten whom. And you have to have a whole field of graduate students do that. Neural networks, this is C. elegans, I'm pretty sure. And these other guys. So these seem to have disassortativity to them, you know, within the era. The internet doesn't seem to be doing that. Anyway. So, general claim, you know, and maybe I would say it's more biological. Some technological ones have this disassortativity to them. So, hubs are connected. It's not completely true, but, you know, big ones are connected to little ones, to big ones, little ones a little bit. Whereas social is more, you know, people with lots of friends or the high collaborators are connected to each other. And the little, you know, you have to really look. I mean, it's one number. So, you have to look at the whole thing to see if that's really true. You know, what's the real distribution of the thing? I mean, the suggestion is big connected guys are connected to each other. And the little ones are just connected. You know, they have one. You have one friend, and your friends have one friend, two friends each. You know, it's all a bit sad. But it could be a little, you know, more mixed than that. These aren't hugely, you know, those numbers aren't one. Oh, yeah. Well, this is just taking some, you know, versions of social networks at some point. It's not looking at the mechanism for how they came about. I mean, homophily is one of the driving, you know, the birds of a feather thing. Although, of course, we have the opposites attract rubbish, right? So who knows, right? But no, it's definitely this, the homophily. That's part of the mechanism. But as it stands at some point in time, it seems that... you know, you have this assortativity, right? So these well-connected characters. So these would be these are authors, for example, here, or actors who have been in films and have many, many connections to each other. Seem to be connected to others, and so it could be the story that you just have, you know, all the people who've acted a lot tend to act a lot with each other, so they're all well mixed. You know, and maybe everyone who's relatively small is connected to someone big. It's just the balance of things makes it look assortative. So you'd actually want to get into that texture, you know. But of course, we like turning things into one number.
Yeah.
But it does give you a suggestion of the tendency of the thing, that it's, is it below zero, zero, or greater than zero? And can you put a, you know, an R squared, like it's kind of an effort to put an R squared there. Okay, so where are we? Gee. Okay, let's have this. Good. I'll look at where we are in time. There are more. Oh. It's pretty awesome. Does anyone know what this quote is from? This is pretty obscure. The original RoboCop. Sorry. kind of a classic moment there. Okay, so you got a couple. All right, so let's have a break and we'll go on to see if we can spread some things on this. There won't be happiness spreading. It'll be math. I'm sorry. And we'll have a little thing at the end to see if it actually, you know, what does this assortativity dial do? When it's degree-based assortativity. Yay. Okay, hot lava. I'm dead. All right, okay.